Hey everyone, this is Sean Moran from the Saving Your Future podcast and YouTube channel, and wanted to welcome today our guest, Lane Fournerat. He is a YouTube content creator and influencer, and he also paid off $70,000 in debt in under 3 years. So he'd have the means to pursue his passion of creating a business around his YouTube channels, the travel vlog family, where he believes in building stronger family bonds with his kids through travel, and also his dad review channel, where he's able to give perspectives and ideas from a dad's perspective in on various products in a more authentic way. So, you know, we welcome Lane to the podcast and the YouTube channel, and thanks so much for taking the time.
Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for having me on.
Appreciate it. I guess what I want to start with is, you know, how did you get in $70,000 in debt? I mean, I know a lot of people have that situation where they create debt. So how did that happen for you?
Sure. Well, I kind of inherited it whenever I got married. My wife went to college and she had a bulk of student loans. That was the majority of it. And we decided after our first daughter was born that we just wanted to knock out the debt. And so we went just kind of smashed at it a little, chipped away at it a little bit at a time to be able to get it down. But yeah, most of it was student loan.
Great. So, I know that the average person, especially getting married or earlier on in your lifetime, you're trying to just keep your head above water and maybe save for a house and, you know, this and that. You know, what was the strategy, or how did you say, well, we're going to take $70,000, divide that by three, really, and, you know, more than $20,000 a year, we're going to knock down in debt. What was the plan behind that? Or was there a plan, or it just kind of happened?
It kind of just happened. One thing that really helped is my wife is a high school science teacher. And so there is a forgiveness plan that the government allows. So we got a good chunk of it taken off from that. We became a one car family. So we sold a car, and that was another nice chunk that we got to put down on it. And then I just started finding every single way that I could find to make money. We went through 5 garage sales. I was selling metal to the scrapyard, putting everything that I had, that any type of money that I can get, birthday money, gift money, everything, and just chunking it at the debt because I just wanted to get rid of it so fast. I hate having to pay bills.
Well, that's great. That's something that a lot of people, you know, don't have. They're more accumulating debt. So to be able to do that's really impressive. So going down to one car, how did that, you know, that'd be interesting to kind of hear a little bit more about your experience there.
Sure. Yeah. Well, before we got into debt, we had just bought 2 new to us cars. And we realized that we could probably get down to one car and use the money that we had in that other car, plus getting rid of the note, and we could just start smashing down at the debt that way. So I mentioned my wife is a high school science teacher, and she has to be at school pretty early in the morning. And at the time, we had two small kids. So I'd get up with her, and we would get everyone ready, and I'd drive her to school, and then I'd drive the kids to the daycare that we had. And then, you know, off to work, and then halfway through, I'd have to go and pick up everybody. And it was a struggle because you feel like a taxi service doing that type of thing whenever you're just a one car, because somebody has to go and pick up somebody. And, but you know, we made it work. We saved on insurance. We saved on gas. We got to put down that huge chunk whenever we sold the other car. It worked out for us really well.
That's great. Yeah. And I can understand that. I have a 4 little ones myself, as I was telling you right before we went live. So, you know, definitely it's a balance of work and family and all that. So, you mentioned that from there you wanted to kind of spend more time with family and get into travel. So how did that, you know, idea come about? And then, you know, as you were paying off the debt, how did you make that vision a reality?
Whenever our daughter was born, we had this crazy idea that we wanted to sell everything we have and buy an RV and just travel around the country. And we were never able to really make it happen. We never could figure out like the right way to do it. And we realized that we had all this overhead that we needed to get rid of to be able to do some kind of traveling, because we knew that we couldn't travel while we were paying off debt because we needed to take that money and throw it at the debt. So once we paid off that debt, we realized that we had some freedom and we were able to go on these road trips because my wife is a teacher. She has the summers almost free. And so we're able to take longer trips and we're able to go and visit family and friends in other states and whatnot. So it gave us some flexibility and the means to actually go about doing something like that. And that's one of the things I'm just super passionate about, because I believe that families really come together whenever they have to travel and they have to work through their problems together and they have to work through all of the things that come up with travel.
Great. So is that more of a summer thing, or is it something you're doing all year round?
It's mainly in the summer, although throughout the year we take smaller like camping trips, or we'll go to like a festival that's in a town nearby. But most of the out of state stuff is usually during the summer, unless I'm going out on like a business trip. I just got back from California this month, and then last month I was in Dallas, Texas. So it goes on throughout the year. It's just not as big as it is in the summer whenever we have a little more time.
Okay. So the kids, I guess, aren't in school yet, or they are?
They are. Yeah, they are.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then, so you talked about the job and you're picking people up, going to work and everything like that. Saw your YouTube channel, one of them, the travel family vlog. And I see you have over 20,000, almost 21,000 subscribers. So did the YouTube channel then replace that work job income, or, you know, how does that play into your financial situation?
I've actually been doing YouTube for a really long time. I used to, in college, I was creating short films. That was 2004, before YouTube. And I was looking for a place to put them, and I stumbled across YouTube, and I just decided to start uploading some of my content to there. And then from there, I started finding some of the other bigger YouTubers that you might know these days, Rhett and Link, Philip DeFranco, iJustine, and I saw what they were doing online. I was like, I think I can do something like that. And so, 2008, I believe, is whenever I kind of gave myself the push to go all in. At the time I was working as a landman for an oil and gas company, and I didn't really care for the work that much. I was more passionate about video. And I just didn't know what niche of video I was truly passionate about. And it took me a really long time to find that. And then that's whenever I came across, you know, wanting to travel with my family. Because at the time I didn't even have kids, just starting a family. And eventually it just kept growing and growing. And we actually documented a lot of our debt-free journey on that YouTube channel that led up to us being able to travel. So that's just very cool to have all that incorporated into one channel.
So people can go on your channel and learn how, you know, more of the, obviously we only have a certain time period here, but they can learn more about how you went and the progress and the process of going from the debt to the debt-free.
Absolutely. We started from the beginning. It'd be a lot of videos to go through, because I did something called daily vlogging, where you make a video every single day, and not every day was about being debt, you know, getting out of debt. But I think I have a playlist somewhere where it kind of incorporates all the debt-free stuff. If you want to put a link to it somewhere, I can send that to you.
Definitely. Yeah. Now we'll link in the description on YouTube and in the show notes on the podcast. All of the things, all the ways that people can find your content.
Awesome.
As someone that also does YouTube, I have a couple channels. My most successful or longest running channel has probably about 400 subscribers. Mm-hmm. So nowhere anywhere near you where you are. So, you know, people obviously watching on YouTube might want to see how they can grow their YouTube channel. For me, the struggle with getting it to grow necessarily was finding, well, what is my niche? And right. I just put up initially, I kind of like what you were saying, is like, I have these videos. I like to do like do it yourself type of thing. So mm-hmm. I was saying, well, somebody else would want to know how to change the garbage disposal, or someone else would want to know how to tighten the banister. And I would just do stupid videos with my cell phone as I was doing things. Mm-hmm. And then probably 2 or 3 years ago is when I started taking it seriously, when you could make, monetize your channel.
Right.
And then they kind of took that away for us smaller people that, have almost nothing. So right. how would somebody that's, you know, maybe 200-300 or even just getting started, what would you say is the best way to grow your channel?
Oh, one, yeah, what you said in the beginning there is finding your niche. One of my first channels was kind of like a science experiment DIY kind of thing like you were, and I just wasn't truly passionate about it. I think if I would have stayed with that, that channel could be a lot bigger than what it is right now, but it just wasn't what I wanted to do. But to grow, you definitely need to pick that niche, and you got to make it very clear to your viewers about what your channel is about. Because once they know, they're going to want to subscribe because they're hopefully interested in the content. Another thing is that you need to have a very strong call to action in your videos. So if you want someone to subscribe, you need to make sure that you tell them to hit that subscribe button, but you also need to tell them why they should subscribe. So like with our traveling channel, I say we believe in building stronger family bonds. So if you're interested in that, you might want to consider clicking that subscribe button. On my dad reviews channel, I talk about if you like these more authentic, unedited, hopefully more authentic looks at the products that I use as a dad, you might want to consider clicking that subscribe button. So you got to grow that subscriber base in the beginning. And the best way to do it is just to give that strong call to action, preferably once in the beginning and then again at the end.
Okay, great. Now, I think that's very helpful because, you know, for me, it's that, and I've seen people say, subscribe to my channel because it helps us out. But you're saying, make sure you let them know why it's valuable to them, which is important.
Exactly.
So let's delve a little bit deeper into the paying off the debt plan. So did you guys sit down with a pen and paper or come together every, you know, like month or a couple weeks or whatever, like, what did that look like to say, hey, this is what it is? And you said about 2 years and 10 months, so less than 3 years. Mm-hmm. Was it a 3-year plan? Was it a, you know, let's see how fast we can get, and it just happened to be, you know, faster than you thought? Or what did that all look like?
Well, we used the Dave Ramsey Total Money Makeover, and we didn't really have a set date or anything like that. We were just like, let's see how fast we can do this. And literally every single penny that came into the house, we were throwing it at debt, and we were doing everything to save those pennies. You know, I wish I had like I did this, and this, and then all of a sudden it was done, but it wasn't that. You know, they say death by a thousand cuts. Well, the same thing is true and opposite. You know, if you go the opposite way, you're cutting your debt, it takes all those little small chipaways to be able to get it done with. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So is it more like, you know, every month you're just, you know, putting together a big check that you're mailing to the, you know, whether it's the student loans or whatever, or is it like every week, or how often, you know, what was the process there?
Anytime we got a decent chunk of money in, $50, $100, $200, whatever it was, we go deposit it in the bank account and send that money out to the student loan person so that we wouldn't even have to deal with it. You know, we had garage sales. So right after the garage sale, we take all that money, deposit it, put it onto the debt. You know, we sold the car, take that money, put it onto the debt. I'd sell scrap metal at the scrap yard, take that money, throw it onto the debt. It was literally just hammering it at any point that I could get. I just wanted to get rid of it.
Yeah, it sounds like a relentless pursuit, and it's a plan. And so basically you're saying any way I possibly can. What kind of sacrifices did you have kind of, you know, like in your daily life, or what did you feel like you missed something by doing that? And, you know, clearly you felt that was more valuable.
Absolutely. I mean, people are going to ask you to go out and have fun, go watch a movie, go hang out and do something. All that's not going to do it. You know, it costs 10 bucks. I'm not going to do it because I want to take that money and throw it towards debt. You know, we want, and every year for Christmas, our family does a white elephant gift. You know, we would buy like one gift as an entire family and play together as a family, as opposed to each having our own individual gifts to be able to play. Going down to one car and having to share a car, you know, taking that time to have to get up in the morning, even though it may be like before the sun comes up, to be able to do that one car thing, you know, taking the time to find stuff on the side of the road that I can sell to the scrapyard, you know, getting rid of all the possessions that you've collected throughout the years and selling them on eBay and Craigslist. I used to be a drummer, and I had a drum set, sold my entire drum set. It's just a myriad of things that we did to be able to knock it out.
That's and I great. Also, I actually did a podcast. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, I realized too, in having the garage sales and selling stuff on eBay and Craigslist and just getting rid of all the stuff, I realized that one, I didn't need all this stuff anymore. And two, I think it helped me to find my passion, which is, you know, the traveling thing and to be able to pursue what I like to do on YouTube.
That's great. No, and I think from what you're saying, sacrifice. I actually did an episode on my podcast about sacrifice and just telling people that, you know, and you, I think you hit the nail right on the head. It's not going to, you know, you're not going to go out to watch to the movies. You're not going to go out to eat. I'm assuming you're probably packing lunch if you're going out, right? Yep. And buying, you know, instead of buying at the McDonald's or whatever it is, right?
Yep, exactly. Peanut butter and jelly.
As long as it's not three meals a day of peanut butter and jelly.
Right, right, exactly. Yeah. Peanut butter Cheerios.
So now where you are, is there, has those kind of habits from paying off the debt continue? And what does that look like? Is there like a big savings plan to maybe early retire or anything like that? Or is it, you know, now we take that money and, you know, use it for trips? Or, you know, what does it look like now that you're out of debt?
I don't have to do all those stupid side jobs and whatnot that I was doing and, you know, find all those different ways to make money. But, there is, you know, we're trying to save as much as we can. It gets harder and harder the more babies we have. And then it seems like, you know, every year we'll get like a good chunk of money saved up. We'll have something and then it's gotta, you know, some of it goes to this or some of it goes to that, you know, something broke down or whatever. So it's been a little bit of a struggle to kind of keep it accumulated. But there is a savings account that is growing there, which is always great to see because you know that you have a safety net there and it's not being thrown away to, you know, Sally Mae or whoever your loan is with.
Sure. No. And that is really huge. Cause I think the rainy day funds, another thing that I talk about in my book is, you know, making sure that you have that money in case the something goes wrong, the car gets a flat tire or, you know, the go out and turn the key and, you know, the battery's dead or, you know, whatever else it might be, you know, something's broken that you need to replace.
Exactly. We needed a new roof for our house. So we needed a down payment to pay for the roof, the roofing guys to come and fix that. And that, you know, we had that saved up in our savings account. We have a, you know, the baby on the way and we have to pay for all those expenses. We had that savings account for that. Granted, a lot of it gets depleted from that, but, you know, it's nice to not have to go back into debt or like really struggle to figure out where that money's going to come from.
That's fantastic. What about retirement plans? Like, do you have, you know, is that important part of your process or I'm assuming maybe your wife at school, that kind of thing. How does that play into the.
Yeah, my wife definitely does have retirement accounts with the school. You know, the teachers get that 403B and all that. I know that I really should probably put a little bit more emphasis into retirement. I haven't, but I also, being an entrepreneur and businessman type of person, I'm always looking for passive sources of income. And I believe that with the businesses that I'm building with my Dad Reviews channel and the Travel Vlog family and some of the consulting that I do, I'm able to create some of those passive incomes through YouTube and affiliate programs and that type of thing.
Great. And so, yeah, I definitely recommend that. So, you know, to the extent that you can create an IRA or, you know, that kind of thing. So,
right.
You know, sooner the better on that. But yeah, with your wife having that, that's definitely going to be valuable as well. And it sounds to me like you're getting that whole package together, which is amazing because too many people aren't, you know, I've seen, right. I think USA Today a few years ago said that the average person age 55 has something like $40,000 saved for retirement.
Wow.
That's
wow.
Not going to cut it.
No, it's not.
That'll last you maybe a year, maybe 2 years if you can really skimp, but that's about it.
Exactly. Wow. That's crazy. That's amazing. Yeah.
So I guess let's talk a little bit more again. So we talked a little about the family channel and then the Dad Reviews. You know, what kind of products and what kind of things would people see if they go to that channel?
Oh, if they go to that channel, I've got pretty much anything that I can get my hands on. I started the channel by just going around the house and picking up things that I can review. And they kind of got the channel going. And now I'm at a point where a lot of companies are reaching out to me and they want me to review their products for them, which has been great. And then I realize as I'm gaining my audience, oh, I can charge these people, you know, $20 here and there to do a video for them. And that's been great. And then also, like I was saying with the Amazon affiliate link, if you use, you know, if you're interested in the product and you use that link, I get a small commission just for sending you there. So it's just, it's been a really great financial aspect of my business that I hadn't really thought about. And it's probably been one of the best things that I've done in the past year for my business. But like, you know, the products that you'll see electronics, you'll see kids games, you'll see movies, you'll see places that we've been. It's just kind of a myriad of things, just all from a dad's perspective, you know, what I really think about these products. And I try to keep them unedited so that it really is like my forethought right here on the screen. And there's no, you know, trying to dance around the subject or anything like that.
I like that. That's a really cool niche. And, you know, for me, my wife has a channel, and she puts a lot of effort into editing and making it perfect. And, you know, for her niche, she needs that. And sometimes I'll just give her a hard time and say, hey, I just reviewed this Bluetooth speaker that I'm putting in my car. You saw I was gone for 3 minutes. I'm done.
Right. Exactly.
I'll do a little bit of editing here and there, but for the most part, it's, you know, what you see is what you get. And, you know, I think there's different, you know, there's room both, obviously, but, you know, that sounds really exciting. I'm definitely gonna check out some of your videos for sure.
Well, then the reason why I decided to do my videos that way is, one, I put a lot of my editing into the travel vlog family. If you go and watch any of those videos, they're pretty highly edited, music and ever graphics and whatnot. And, I realized that I could only do those once a week. And whenever I decided to start the dad reviews, I realized whenever I was searching for a hiking backpack, I found a guy who was like literally sitting at his bed and he was just showing off the backpack unedited and just giving like his real review of it. And I was like, that's the kind of review that I like. I don't like the reviews where they like show a picture of the product and it doesn't really do anything and you don't feel them handling it and moving it. And I like the tactical stuff whenever it comes to a product review, not the beauty, if that makes sense.
Sure. And what I sense is the energy that you have. You know, I think that energy comes across and people really appreciate the fact that, you know, it's, you're passionate about it. And to me, that's huge.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I've kind of got a specific format that I follow with my videos, and it's from what the responses that I'm getting from people, they seem to really be liking it. So it's exciting.
So do you think that YouTube is, and you know, for some people, obviously not, you know, this is like anything else, you know, you can be an accountant, you can be a teacher, you can be whatever. Do you think YouTube can be a full-time business where, you know, you can make a significant income, you know, just doing YouTube? Is that something you've experienced, or do you think, you know, hey, I'm a year away from that, or what does that look like?
Absolutely. You can definitely do it. I've seen so many people and I have so many friends in the YouTube space who have done that. And it's just a matter of putting in the time and having the passion for it. You got to really want to do it because it's hard to get into. You know, you got to study, you got to learn from all the gurus out there and put their advice into action, be able to take the time to want to do it. It's a lot of like data and behind the scenes stuff that most people don't want to do. A lot of people think, oh, I filmed this video and I'm done. But, you know, you got to go in and look at your analytics. How's the video performing? Did it convert people? Are people buying through your links? What's the audience retention on it? How's your click-through rate on your thumbnails? You know, all that type of stuff. Most people don't think about whenever they think about creating a YouTube channel.
That makes sense. It's not just saying, okay, here's my 3-minute video. Here you go, YouTube, now subscribe. It's right. There's a lot more involved in it. So it is like a job. It's not just I'll just do 10 minutes a day talking about a product.
Right. And the way I look at it too, is it's a job and your job is to create these video assets. And these assets are like employees and they're going to work for you 24/7, even while you sleep. So if you can get enough of them, hopefully YouTube likes it and they keep performing for you day in and day out. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. No, I've read and kind of listened to a lot of that stuff too. And I find it interesting and you know, I'm kind of glad to see, you know, someone with such a passion for what they're doing. What other, you know, again, being a finance podcast, what other kind of things might you share with someone that's like, you know, hey, maybe you can inspire them, put them on the right track for, you know, whether it's paying down debt or something else to, you know, set yourself up financially successful?
Sure. Well, I always go back to kind of my entrepreneur mindset. Whenever I was in college, I had my own vending machines that I would, trying to make a little business out of and whatnot. And I think what most people don't realize is that YouTube should be your, if you have a business, should be your advertising stream for yourself. In fact, with our baby that's on the way, we're using a midwife to deliver our babies, and I'm actually helping her to build her YouTube channel so that she can find different, more ways to monetize than what she was already doing, which was delivering babies. And I think I've really opened her eyes to everything that you can do once you decide to go down the rabbit hole of not just YouTube, but it could be anything from YouTube to podcasting to creating a Facebook page, a blogging, anything like that. Anything that gets a message out there with something that you're passionate about, you can find a way to monetize it. I've heard video people, and I've had a lot of experience with finding many ways to monetize the YouTube channel besides, just AdSense, affiliates, sponsorships. You can even potentially get speaking gigs as you get higher and higher into more and more people find you. You build that influence. You can license your videos. You can sponsor other products. People can sponsor you through things like Patreon or the YouTube sponsor thing that's coming up. There's super chats for live streams. There's so many ways to monetize, and a lot of people just don't realize what's out there. And once you dip your foot in there, it's really hard to leave because it's just so lucrative.
Yeah, no, and I like what you said about the entrepreneur side, because I also own a wireless zone Verizon retail store. Mm-hmm. And probably about a year in, not even a year, probably about 6 or 8 months into owning that store, I said, you could spend all this money on advertising, or I can create videos saying, here's this new phone, here's this accessory, here's whatever. Mm-hmm. And people are going to watch that. And then to me, it's even more, there's the, hey, I'm providing content and value to people. But even more so, what I'm doing is with my links and my descriptions and my tags on the video, I'm hopefully having people saying, hey, where's the nearest Verizon store? And one of my videos will come up. So it's not on TV, but it's a commercial for my product.
Sure, absolutely. It's a commercial that actually gives the viewer value. That's the problem with most commercials that you see on TV. There's really no value to it besides, I guess, maybe entertainment, like during a Super Bowl commercial. But, people go to YouTube usually with a problem. And if you can be the person to fix that problem for them, there's a trust factor that's built there. And once you start to build that trust, they're going to be like, oh, yeah, that guy, he has a business. I can go get my phone over there. I can go get it fixed. I can go buy a new one. I can, get some service from them, whatever it happens to be. It opens up a door for those customers to be able to find you. And YouTube is the number two search engine in the world, right behind Google, and Google owns YouTube. So, you can't go wrong.
Absolutely. I tell people the same thing, from an entrepreneur's perspective, use this tool because it's there for you. And so I appreciate that, because that's going to help other entrepreneurs that, listen to this part and hear what you're saying. Hopefully that inspires a few people to do that. And that's the idea of why I'm doing this channel, is just more to, I learned a lot from others and from, sweat equity and figuring it out. Mm-hmm. To, be able to give some of that back to other people is huge.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. 100%. You got to put in the work that it takes to build it. But once you get it going, it's good. And you can help a lot of people. That's the cool thing about YouTube too, is that once you find something that you love, you can really find the audience for it who's really looking for it, and you can help them in so many ways. And that's what you want to do whenever you're coming to YouTube. You want to be of service to somebody. You want to be able to give them what they need, and then hopefully they give you in return by supporting you and giving you business and that type of thing.
Yeah, no, and I want to thank you for doing your part in actually helping educate our audience too. And I'll link your descriptions below, and it's great. I think this type of collaboration is good for everybody. So
absolutely.
In closing, is there anything else you'd like to share? I mean, this was a lot of information already, and greatly appreciate your time.
Absolutely. No, we just talked about so much. Let me think. I tell you to if you really want to, let's talk about debt first. If you really want to get out of debt, you just got to do it. You got to put pen to paper, find out what all of your debts are, and just knock them out as fast as you can. For me, what one thing that kept me on track was to create the videos that I was creating. It was a motivational thing for me. Yeah, I just paid off $100. We just had a garage sale, another $200 out. You know, it's those small wins for me, and then me to be able to take a video and create it based around that, that really fueled my fire to want to do more, because I got to basically relive it whenever I'd have to go and edit those videos again. So I think a part of this for me was accountability, and I just happened to do that through YouTube. It may not be for you, the listener, but I'd tell you to find whatever's going to make you accountable for it. Is it going to be putting it on YouTube and having an audience, a podcast, writing in your journal, sharing on a blog? Find that thing that's going to drive you to want to be able to do the things that you want to do.
Well, thank you so much, Lane. I greatly appreciate it. This was very insightful. And to the audience, thank you for listening, and definitely check out Lane's channels, and if you, this was good for, really helped you, tell us what you took away from it. It was a lot of information to digest. I was definitely inspired by the way that you had a passion for taking down debt, and the way that you document it, and the way that you're growing your YouTube channels and your passion. So thank you so much for taking the time to do this.
Oh, thank you for having me. I definitely appreciate it. I love talking about this. So if anybody wants to connect with me on Twitter, I'm at LaneVids. Feel free to shoot me any questions. I'm happy to answer.
Fantastic. Thanks so much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.